Good morning, counsel.
Morning, Your Honor. Gary Finn for the petitioner and appellant, Jose Luis Galvan-Avila. My client, Mr. Galvan, is here today observing the argument. Your Honors, back in 1994, my client was placed into removal proceedings. At that time, they were called deportation proceedings, actually. And he was absolutely eligible to apply for Section 212C relief at that time. The immigration judge gave my client, who was in detention, not represented at the time, an absolutely incorrect statement of the law and told my client that he had no chance for relief. The immigration judge told my client in 1994.
Are you familiar with an en banc case from a few years back called U.S. versus Lopez Velasquez?
I'm not.
From our court?
No, Your Honor, I'm not.
Because that seems to squarely foreclose your argument on his eligibility for 212C relief.
I have trouble. I don't want to question what you're telling me, really. But I, at the time, that case may have been interpreting other sections of the law. But at the time, back in 1994, a person could continue to accrue time for eligibility. What a person, an immigrant, needed in order to qualify for 212C relief back before the law changed, before 212C was eliminated, was 7 years of lawful, unrelinquished domicile, not 7 years with a green card. There was no stop time rule. Today in immigration law, we
have
a stop
time. But isn't your argument that the immigration judge had to tell him about this?
Yes.
Well, that's the part that the case
at a minimum,
precludes you.
This is a case not it's worse than just an omission of an important fact. It's a misstatement. It's a misadvisal of what the law was at the time. I've been practicing immigration law since before the laws changed in 1996, and with 212C waivers, a person could even appeal the case if they didn't have the 7 years. A person could appeal the case, and the time towards the 7 years of lawful unrelinquished domicile would continue to accrue through the time of the appeal.
Well, counsel, because you don't have a whole lot of time, let me just add my voice that with respect to your request to amend the 2241 habeas petition into a 2255, the Lopez Velasquez case, as my colleague suggested, completely forecloses that argument. But you do have two other potentially really good arguments, one of which has to do with the 212C motion and the question of whether the IG actually ruled on his 212C motion and the BIA didn't address it. Under the circumstances, what are we to do with that?
Well, I think this court should, looking at all the circumstances, the fact that at least at the time in 1994, and I apologize for not being familiar with this Lopez Velasco case. I'll certainly look at it immediately after the argument today. But back in 1994, the petitioner, Mr. Galvan, would have been eligible for the relief. And I'm sorry, I don't know if I'm addressing your question exactly.
Okay, my question is this. Putting aside for a moment the request to amend the 2241 petition, there are two other avenues which I think are encompassed within your pleading, one of which is the original 212C motion. The IJ did not rule on it, potentially. We're not sure. The record is not clear on that, but the BIA clearly didn't address it. Under the circumstances, what do we do with that? Do we send it back to the BIA to consider the petition in the first instance? What do we do?
I think so, Your Honor. I think that would be the thing to do because my client even attempted to file a motion to reopen. It's in the transcript of the hearing, and it didn't, for some reason, it didn't make it into the record. He was unrepresented. He tried to file it with the immigration court.
Okay.
He was detained, and for some
reason. So you think we ought to send that back? Yeah. For the BIA to consider.
Yes, because
moving to the second issue, what about Barajas Romero? What impact does that have on your case?
I don't know of that one either.
We need to get you some new legal materials.
I think so, yeah.
Anyway, that's a case that changed the definition of what needs to be shown when you have a membership in a particular social group, and changed it from one central reason to was a reason.
Okay, so Your Honor, now you're talking about the
withholding
of removal.
Exactly.
Yeah,
I'm okay. Just moving to the next issue.
Okay.
Because you don't have a lot of time.
All right. Well, I think that the record has plenty of evidence to show that the persecution that the respondent fears in Mexico, one central reason for that is an imputed political opinion.
Okay, but remember what we're talking about here, Barajas Romero changes. So it is no longer one central reason, it's just a reason, which makes it easier for your client.
Right.
So what do we do with that?
Well, I mean, I think that the record has enough evidence for the court to remand the case to the BIA with instructions that the application for withholding of removal be granted.
Or at least considered under
the new
standard.
How can we do that when they haven't evaluated it under the correct standard in the first instance?
I agree. They would have to do that. You're correct, Your Honor. It could be remanded for them to for the BIA to review the case under the proper standard. That would be the thing to do. But I'd like to point out, and then I'll save some time for rebuttal. The whole, my client, since he was, and I would argue, unlawfully deported back in 1994, the reinstatement of removal and this subsequent proceeding that he's in right now are all tainted by that original deportation, which I would argue was not lawfully executed. And so I think that we would be content if the case was remanded to look at the withholding of removal case, but I think that what should really happen is that the case should be remanded so that the court, as Your Honor suggested, the BIA should consider the motion to reopen the 1994 deportation. So that's what I think should happen first, and I'll reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal. Is that all right?
Yeah, okay, no, that's fine. You're going to save the rest of your time for now. We'll hear from the government.
Probably right.
Mm-hmm. Good morning.
May it please the court, Kyle Ryan for the United States. I'll just address the 212C issue first. The reason the immigration judge did not consider the 212C issue in 2013 is because the defendant had previously been deported, and he was in withholding-only proceedings.
I can almost not hear you. Can you talk up just a little?
He was in withholding-only proceedings. These are the type of proceedings where the immigration judge can only consider withholding of removal under the Act and protection under the Convention Against Torture. So when the defendant tried to raise the 212C issue in those proceedings, the immigration judge properly informed him that the correct action was to file a motion to reopen.
But the immigration judge, if I understand the record correctly, counsel, did not rule on the 212C motion. Even if he said it wasn't correct, he didn't rule on it, right? And the BIA didn't consider it.
Correct, because it was not before the immigration judge in the withholding-only proceedings. The immigration judge did issue some sort of an advisory if these were before the court that they were not valid due process claims. But because they were not actually before the immigration judge in that withholding-only proceeding, the BIA did not address them.
Because it's reinstatement, he can't take up that issue anyway.
That's correct. It's a withholding-only proceeding because they were reinstating a prior removal. The defendant did eventually file a motion to reopen, which the immigration judge denied. That's not part of the record here. It is referenced in the record. The defendant did not appeal that denial of the motion to reopen to the Board of Immigration Appeals, yet he did include it in his opening brief to this court. It's not properly before the court. But even if it was, the defendant's not eligible for 212C relief. And he became, to be eligible for 212C relief, you have to have 7 years of lawful domicile in the United States as either a lawful temporary resident under Section 245A or a lawful permanent resident.
Let me be sure I understand the government's argument on 212C. You're saying that while nothing happened at this particular time, the 212C motion was later on brought before the IJ. It was denied, and he didn't appeal it. Is that
correct? That's correct, Your Honor.
And so that's not before the record, and we need not be concerned about the 212C issues. That's your position, right?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay.
He was not eligible at the time because he became a lawful temporary resident in September 1987, and he was deported in January 1994. He didn't have the 7 years at that time, so he wasn't eligible for 212C.
We understand that. Now, what's your position about Barajas Romero?
Right.
That standard has changed and might make a difference in this case, would it not?
The standard has changed, but I don't think it makes a difference. There's no evidence of a nexus in this case to a particular social group. The particular social group that was articulated in this case is extremely vague and ambiguous. It's the defendant's wife's family. At some point, they even include a brother-in-law's sister-in-law in this group. You know, this is not a particular social group. It doesn't meet the requirements for particularity and social distinction. The immigration judge didn't actually address that point. She basically said that even assuming this was a particular social group, there's no evidence that the defendant or anyone else was harmed or targeted on account of their membership in that group. And that's one of the problems with...
Well, but what do we do with the fact that the BIA's analysis relied on the one central reason test, which Barajas Romero now says is not the right test? Isn't the appropriate solution is to remand it for them to reanalyze it under the correct test,
present a
record, and then we'll take a look at what they say about a particular social group?
I think looking at the evidence in the record, it's clear that it wasn't one central reason. It wasn't one reason for the harm. No one knows the reason why these people were targeted. Mexico and Tijuana are violent places. The case law is clear that generalized violence does not create a nexus to a particular social group.
So I gather what the government is advocating is that our court, as opposed to the BIA or an IJ, should apply the new standard under Barajas Romero to the facts in the record. Is that correct?
That's one way the court could go about it. I mean, the immigration judge denied it on several bases, so I think that you could deny it. You could affirm the Board of Immigration Appeals on the nexus ground. You could affirm on the fact that the defendant was able to relocate within Mexico. We could affirm on the basis that...
How do we know that?
That he's able to relocate within Mexico.
Were there findings in the record that suggested that would have been possible and he could have avoided harm?
Yes, Your Honor. All of the harm that was cited by the defendant in testimony and the other evidence was related to Tijuana. Tijuana is one city in Mexico. It's a big country. The defendant could relocate to another area within Mexico.
I understand that, but I guess my question is, did the IJ make a determination that because the petitioner is from Tijuana, that he could go to some other place, Veracruz or some other place, and he'd be safe?
Yes, she did say that he could relocate within Mexico, and it would be reasonable to do so in this case. If the court would like me to address the relation back issue or anything else, I can move on to that.
Any questions by my colleagues? I don't think we do have.
Okay, the government submits them. Thank you.
Very well. Counsel, you have some rebuttal time.
I'd like to address a little bit the relation back issue, actually, because when my client originally filed his...
Before you do that, you heard what we said about Lopez Velasquez. The issue you want to talk about is foreclosed by that case, so relating back is kind of irrelevant. You can talk about it if you want to, but that's not going to help you.
Okay. Would I be able to maybe have a post-argument brief and address that case, the Lopez Velasco case? I don't know that it applies to my client's eligibility for 212C in 1994.
That's not our normal practice. We can read the case, unless my colleagues want that, I think we will respectfully decline your offer.
Okay. Well, at least with respect then to the relation back issue, I'm talking now about the 1326 prosecution that my client in his petition alleged ineffective assistance of counsel. Actually, his defense attorney helped him fill out the form for the petition and selected to file under 2241, which turned out to be incorrect also. But if you look at ground three, and this is in my opening brief in case number 13-56205, the petition for the original petition for habeas corpus is attached, and on ground three, the petitioner, Mr. Galvan, who was then in pro per, addresses the issue of the prior deportation order, which he alleges was flawed, and that is the issue that when Mr. Galvan amended the petition to be coming under 2255, that issue was raised. It was maybe raised a little bit inartfully, perhaps, but the 2255 petition relates back to that occurrence, the 1994 deportation order. And so the amended petition under 2255 should be accepted should have been accepted by the district court in the interests of justice. Also because the argument raised in the 2255, the amendment, relates back to an argument that was raised in the 2241 petition.
Your time is up. We appreciate your argument for both counsel. The case just argued is submitted.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.